So the time has finally come. The cult action DIY masterpiece Deadbeat at Dawn from Jim VanBebber is now available in a Blu-ray. The film, which is 4K restored, remastered, looks better than ever. Jim VanBebber looks and sounds better than ever. And the extras, it's an incredible film. And if you love 70s grindhouse, epic action, authentic, gritty action, you must watch this film. So, a little bit of background, who is Jim VanBebber? Because you may have heard about him over the years, the Manson family, Deadbeat at Dawn, various music videos for Philip Anselmo, Down, Skinny Puppy, Necrophagia, what have you. Jim VanBebber starts out as just a young guy, an Ohio-based filmmaker, obsessed with monsters and making movies, makes his own little movies on Super 8. In fact, there's I was going back in the old issues of Cinemagic, and there is a little in Cinemagic, it was like the early version of like the internet. It was a movie making magazine in the late 70s and early 80s, and you could write to Cinemagic and post articles about films that you were making, little Super 8 16mm little student films that you were making. And there's a little posting from Jim VanBebber in one issue of Cinemagic, and then right next to it is Mike King, who would go on to become his collaborator, his cameraman. Mike King has his own little production right next to it, so it's just a funny thing. So in the mid 80s, Jim VanBebber found himself at Wright State University. At a certain point, he decided, okay, I don't want to finish my degree here. I'm going to go out and take the money earmarked for Scholastics. I'm going to buy some reversal film, and I'm going to start shooting a feature film. I mean, I think the idea for Deadbeat at Dawn kind of emerged out of trying to make these little action movie demos and doing things in a bigger way, and then eventually, oh my God, now they're making Deadbeat at Dawn. So Deadbeat at Dawn is a film where Jim VanBebber, he directs, he wrote it or co-wrote it, he co-produced it with Mike King and Marcelo Gomez, and I believe some other guy. They kind of formed this company as Modius Productions. It's an action film where Jim VanBebber plays Goose, the leader of a gang, of a street gang, and he clashes with this other street gang led by this guy Danny, this bad kind of character Danny, played by Paul Harper. And at the beginning of the film, they have a fight, a brawl at a cemetery, which kind of where Goose wins, but bloodied but victorious. Danny doesn't like that so much, and so he vows bloody revenge against Goose, and basically, you know, strikes against Goose's family, his girl, and you know, Goose is trying to get out of the game. He's trying to do, you know, the Easy Rider thing, the one last drug deal, and ride off in the sunset. But as soon as he's out, they pull him back in, and so he gets into this bloody conflict with Danny, which leads to eventually them pulling a heist, an armored truck heist, where there's a double cross. Goose starts running off with the money, and there is this a series of brawls and fight scenes, and then the film ends in this incredible clash between Danny and Goose. I mean, the film, it was, I mean, made by students in their 20s, doing crazy things. It's gritty, it's authentic. The street gang, the film has elements of hyper-stylized, you know, there is elements of realism to it, and I mean, the fight scenes are incredible. I mean, the action scenes in this film, they have a rhythm, they have a balance, they have peaks and valleys. I mean, the opening fight scene in the cemetery it starts off with guns drawn, then with a knife fight, and it's very realistic in a way, because people get slash, and then they have to stop, because obviously, you know, in the real world, if somebody slashed up your hand and your head, you know, blood starts pouring into your eyes, you get blind to things, and it's not this kind of jingoistic kind of Arnold Schwarzenegger kind of just, you know, somebody can take, you know, 5 slugs to the shoulder and they're all fine. No, it's a very kind of gritty, realistic, kind of like a brawl, just a people just scrambling, fighting for their life. And these kind of action scenes continue throughout the film. I mean, VanBebber's kind of approach to violence is very realistic, but then also kind of hyper stylized in the mode of a Clockwork Orange or the Warriors. This is, or Assault on Precinct 13. This is more of a street gang, more like the Warriors and Assault on Precinct 13. It's more of this very kind of cinematic, hyper stylized type of action. If you're a fan of 70s kind of gritty grindhouse action films in the style of Charles Bronson, Chuck Norris, that type of thing, this film is right up your alley. And the end scene in the rail yard where with the final fights, which is it really shows off VanBebber's. You can tell he's heavily inspired, and he even talks about this in the commentary track. He's heavily inspired by Tom Laughlin, by Billy Jack, and he has that kind of Billy Jack type of karate choreography where it's very cutty. It's cut, fight, slow motion. Motion fight, you know, cut, slow motion, da 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 da. But it's like Tom Laughlin sped up like 200%. It's really fast, aggressive, incredibly well choreographed, and lots of cuts, lots of dynamic. I mean, the film, I mean, people have talked about this film. I mean, every time you talk about this movie, you have to talk about it in the terms of an independent film, of a DIY type of a movie. And if you're an independent artist or a filmmaker, the story of Jim VanBebber really calls out to you. Because anyone who's tried to make a film or make any kind of art, especially filmmaking, if you've gone to film school and come out, you realize that most of what you've been told, what you've been read, what you've learned about filmmaking is not true. That the filmmaking is the domain, is a very inauthentic domain. It's the domain of trust funds, of nepotism, of nasty, dirty behavior. And when you find something that's authentic, somebody really going for it, making something real and gritty and authentic, coming out of nowhere with just their friends and a few dollars and just doing it on 16 millimeter, and it's this raw statement, that really attracts you. And I think over the years, people from the punk world, from the independent, from the music world, from the independent filmmaking, horror filmmaking world have sought out Jim VanBebber because of this film, really, because of the rawness of the film. It's just a kind of thing. But even putting that aside, putting out on the, you know, the indie DIY ethos, putting that aside, Deadbeat at Dawn is just a hell of an action film. It has an incredible story. There's never a point where it just stops. It's loose. It never lets up. It never lets you go. The action scenes are engaging. They're incredibly well shot. They're incredibly professionally well done in a way, and the low budget nature. The low budget nature just enhances the feel of the grittiness of the film. And there's dangerous stunts. Jim VanBebber engages. I mean, watching this Blu-ray, just the stuff that he does. The end fight scene where the armored car Brinks robbery, they set a mattress on fire and throw it in the middle of the street. He rappels off of a six-story parking garage. I think he only does it four stories, but you see him hanging there, and there's no wires, there's no CGI. He's literally hanging off this parking garage, rappelling down to the. He jumps into a dam. He jumps off the rails and into a dam, being chased by a car, which in the commentary track you say is full of drunk people driving it. He's being chased by this car. He jumps off into the water, into the freezing water in March, in Ohio. And then at the very end of the film, he's dragged. He's like in Maniac Cop 2, that stunt where he was being there. People, somebody's hanging off the side of a car being driven down the street. Well, he did that. He was hanging out of the car and driving into an alley. Jim VanBebber is hanging off the side of a car being skidded off the side of this building, and apparently his shoulder hit a hinge on this door in this alley, and he ripped his shoulder open. I mean, it's incredibly dangerous. And then in the outtakes you see him jump. The end of the film is the climax. The action climax is shot at this railroad yard. Don't know how they were shooting there. I mean, I don't know why the railroad police didn't run him off, but they didn't. I think they were running and gunning. And there's a scene in the outtakes where there's a lot of more dangerous stuff in the outtakes where they're jumping off fences and the stuff that's not super dangerous. But the one dangerous thing in the outtakes was he jumps onto this moving train, and then jumps off of it. And they do these action scenes like literally 2 feet from the train that's running right beside them. And I mean, they could have gotten, you know, if there was something hanging off that train, it could have killed them. There's a scene where one of the things is that, you know, he's kind of this kind of karate ninja, but it's like street, it's like Escape from New York, it's like Street Thunder, it's like, but he has all these throwing stars. And there's this one scene toward the end of the film where they're about to do the heist, the Brinks robbery, and Jim VanBebber is just trying to be badass, and he takes out this throwing star and he throws it and he hits the wall all in this one shot. And I was like, you know, now I'm like, you know, there's a guy right to the left of him. He could have hit him, you know. And self-admittedly, they were drinking. There was a lot of stuff, you know, going around. It's amazing somebody didn't get hurt with the amount of just little things like throwing stars, like right inches from people's heads. You know, working with moving trains, where you know it's amazing that somebody didn't get their arms and legs chopped off or something didn't happen. I think it's just a testament to the energy of this film that just, it's just so exuberant. It's beyond just an interest in the underground and the DIY. This film, I mean, if you show it to anybody who loves gritty 70s film, which I think the people who love that type of movie, they don't seem to be young people. I mean, there's no Transformers robots. There's no Iron Man. Well, there is an Iron Man. He's Jim VanBebber. That's the real Iron Man. There's no Doctor Strange. There's no Spider-Man in this film, but there's a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, and you see it, and it's all on the screen, and it's incredible. I mean, the film was shot over a period of weekends, took years to make, and was released initially on Ketchum Video, on a VHS. that Jim VanBebber always talks about as kind of being a bootleg. I never got a lot of information on how that film, that VHS, was released. But the film was kind of released around 1988, and around 1997, 98, Synapse, Don May Jr.'s DVD label, released it onto a DVD, which had some extras, had a commentary track, which was the people involved: Jim VanBebber, Mike King, Mark Pittman, who plays, oh my God, I didn't mention Bone Crusher. I mean, that's one of the indelible images of this film, Bone Crusher. There's so many indelible shots in this movie. There's a shot at the very end with Jim VanBebber, going crazy, shooting wild, jumping off, swinging the chain like through the air, like Tarzan swinging on the chain. And then there's that shot with a handheld 360 degree going around Bone Crusher, which is one of the Bone Crusher is, Mark Pittman is one of the greatest, it's one of the great parts of the movie, where he talks about, I hate everybody, oh my God. But then you see Bone Crusher in other scenes and he's kind of pathetic. He's just a junkie. He's just a hollow shell. All he is full of hate. Again, an incredible performance that kicks this movie up to a different level. But anyway, Mark Pittman and Mike King, they were all on the commentary track of this Synapse DVD. It had some of his short films, because after Deadbeat Dawn, they made this, Jim VanBebber made this film called My Sweet Satan, which is it's a short film. It's based on the Ricky Cazzo murder. So Might Sweet Satan and a few other, Chunk Blower, which was a promo that Jim VanBebber directed for a Canadian horror film. And so it was a fundraising promo, but the final film was never shot, but he shot on 35mm, and it's a very nice looking little short, promotional clip for a film which was never financed and never shot. That was on the thing. Jim VanBebber was never happy with that video transfer. The ironic thing is that I think Jim VanBebber was right about that video transfer. I mean, the end of the transfer, with the end scene at the rail yard, it was obvious he was shot over many, many months, and the exposure, the sky, I mean, it was not balanced out. It really looked like a one light. The sky was blue in one shot, it was gray in another shot. It wasn't properly color timed. There was a 2008 video release, kind of about 20 years after. So this was about 10 years. The Synapse DVD was about 10 years. 2008, there was a box set, Visions of Hell, which had a version of Deadbeat at Dawn paired with the Manson family. Of course, after My Sweet Satan and Deadbeat at Dawn, Jim VanBebber embarked on this 10-year-plus quest to finish this movie on Charles Manson, Charlie's family, which became the Manson family. Really, it was focused more on the everything surrounding Manson, not just Manson himself. But that was released in around 2003, and by Severin Films, and they came out with a DVD box set, Dark Sky. It was David Gregory with Severin Films. Dark Sky released the initial DVD of the Manson family, and then they released this Visions of Hell, which had an upgraded transfer. Now, finally, Arrow Video has come to the rescue, has remastered Deadbeat at Dawn in 4K, and the film looks incredible. The film, it's amazing to look at. The transfer is both gritty and 16mm. It shows its 16mm roots, but in other ways, it feels like 35mm. It feels incredible. It has that grit. The end of the film is finally, it looks beautiful. It's been properly color timed. It has that modern digital post. It's all timed properly. The problems of the Synapse DVD are through. The film looks incredible. It comes with a really nice booklet, which has a lot of nice stills of Jim VanBebber throughout the making of Deadbeat at Dawn. It has the extras. I mean, all of these releases have kind of slightly different extras, and the commentary track that was on the Synapse DVD is not on the Dark Sky DVD, and it's kind of a bit of a mix-up. The Dark Sky didn't have any commentary, but it had a little featurette, and it had some of his short films. Now, the Arrow Video release has a new commentary track by VanBebber and Paul Harper. Danny, who we didn't really hear about. Danny didn't really show up in the first DVD and the second DVD, I don't think. He's now included in a documentary from Vincent Bonacor, who was also involved in the Jim VanBebber documentary from a couple of years ago, Diary of a Deadbeat, which I've not watched yet. I need to check that out. But Bonacor and Cody Lee Harper and Paul Harper and VanBebber himself doing a really nice commentary, and it really, VanBebber sounds like that. He sounds almost exactly like that professional young man from the late 80s. If you watch any VHS really, really early interviews with Jim VanBebber, it was sad to see Jim VanBebber on that Manson Family document. That was a documentary that I used to go back to a lot. There was this documentary on the Manson family, on that original Dark Sky release, and then the Severn Films Blu-ray, where you see him drinking during the release, and it's like, and I know the interview is not presented in a chronological order in the documentary, probably, but he seems getting drunker as he goes along, and so there's a lot of, I did love in that documentary where he has like the Billy Jack 45 in the background. He's got it on the wall. That was cool. Billy Jack, One Tin Soldier. But VanBebber looks great. He sounds great on the commentary track. It seems like a bunch of very collegial, two people who work together. Paul Harper and Jim VanBebber work together on this film, and they sound great on the commentary track. I think the commentary track has a lot of detail. I haven't listened to the original Deadbeat at Dawn, the original Synapse commentary track. It was years ago. It was okay. I really watched that Manson Family documentary a lot. It has a lot of details on Jim VanBebber. But the new documentary, which I guess is kind of an outgrowth of Vincent Bonacor and his work with Diary of Deadbeat, there's this, I think it's like about 70-80 minute documentary on this Blu-ray, which kind of, it's a great overview of the early years of Jim VanBebber, the student films. This film, My Sweet Satan, is covered as well a little bit. Even they go into little obscure areas like Andy Kopp and The Mutilation Man, which was a film, which Andy Kopp was an Ohio-based, the late Andy Kopp, Ohio-based filmmaker. And he made this film, it's kind of experimental film called The Mutilation Man. I think it's shot in 16 or Super 8. It was actually shot in a film. And it has Jim VanBebber in a part as the character's father, right? I think it was in flashbacks. It's been a while. But it's a real career overview documentary. Wonderful. And the short films, not all of his short films are presented on this Blu-ray, but the important films like My Sweet Satan and Chunk Blower and Into the Black and Roadkill, The Last Days of John Martin, they're all presented and remastered, redone and they look like they were shot yesterday. They look as incredible as Deadbeat at Dawn. I mean, it's just the new post-production. Oh, everything in this release, the film material just looks so beautiful, so filmic. It's a really incredible release. It's a great release to check out. The films of Jim VanBebber are a national treasure. And I don't know how anyone who could claim to be a lover of grindhouse, of action films, could not love these films. I mean, this film. I mean, maybe you don't love My Sweet Satan or the other stuff, but Deadbeat is just a stone cold great action film, and it's a wonderful film, and it lives on in this release. The legacy of Deadbeat at Dawn lives on in this release. It blows me away. It's incredible.
On behalf of the motion picture industry, welcome to the world of home video entertainment.